up in a mixed up world. You're in the sweet spot, baby. You're in the sweet spot, girl. You're in the sweet spot, darling. It's a magical kingdom in a mixed up world.
Welcome to the Sweep Spot Podcast. My name is Lynn, your host, and Ken's my co-host. Ken, what's going on?
Oh, it is going. It is going. And I'm so happy to be here for this episode of the Sweep Spot Podcast.
Episode 283.
What?
Two? Really? No, three. 383.
I was going to say, you lost 100 there.
383.
But,
wow.
But wait, there's more. 383. Lynn, that's hard. That's so hard to believe it. You couldn't remember it.
I know. I think that's why I said two, because
it's
just
hard
seems
to believe, isn't it?
Ridiculous.
Yeah, I had we're to almost double to 400. Check. Yeah.
Can you imagine that? 400. And we probably have more if you were to count all the current event shows. That's, we don't count those. Yeah. Wow. Well, anyways, Ken and I are both former Disneyland Custodial cast members, and we host the number one Disneyland podcast, hosted by two former Disneyland custodians.
Number one.
We are also authors of the books Cleaning the Kingdom. We have two volumes, two different books called Cleaning the Kingdom, two different subtitles, and you can get both of those on Amazon. They are not signed on Amazon, but if you want a signed book by both of us, we only have the second book available at the moment, and you can get that at thesweetspot.com. You can also get both books at Kindle or wherever digital books are found, and both books are on audio. So if you want the audiobooks, you can get those at Audible or wherever audiobooks are found.
But what if they put the books under their pillows at night? Will the autograph fairy come around and autograph the books for them?
They might.
I suppose it's possible.
I mean, if you really want them signed, you can send a self-addressed, you know, like a thing or whatever.
Pay for it. Well, bring them to D23.
That's true. I was going to mention that later. We're going to be at D23 or whatever they're calling it, the Disney Ultimate event,
the Ultimate Fan Experience.
We're going to be there, so if you're going to that, you know what it is. If you don't know what it is, then it doesn't matter because they're sold out.
Yeah. Sold out by popular demand.
Yeah. So, yeah, you can do that. And if you don't have the books and you want them autographed, we will be there signing and autographing both of the books. Also, we have a Patreon if you'd like to help support the show. We'd love that. And you get some great perks. You get one bonus episode per month that you get to listen to. And then also you get to join in the current events as we do that once a month. We have, we record them live when you are in the chat room, and you can kind of, you know, discuss things with the others in the chat room. And then sometimes we'll read your comments as we record, but it's a lot of fun. And we do that once a month, and I usually send out an invitation, like the week before, and then like a couple days before, and then the day of, just to remind everyone.
Make their plans. All right.
But we mentioned D23. I think that's it. Ken, who is our guest tonight?
Well, we have artist Shawna Tice. And if you've ever noticed, maybe you haven't even noticed, but you should, when you go through like the shops on Main Street and stuff like that, how the interiors are decorated, or
windows on Main Street. Yeah.
Windows, and not the names on the windows. I'm talking about like just the displays and things like that. But just, there's so many things throughout the park that are maybe smaller projects. You know, it's not major construction projects, but they involve decorating and a lot of artwork and design. Well, she has experience with that. So like, for instance, she was in entertainment art and things like that. So she's going to talk about those things. So you definitely want to stay tuned and listen to us chatting with her.
I'm excited. Let's get right into it.
Looking to go to Disneyland Resort in California, Walt Disney World Resort in Florida, Alani in Hawaii are on a Disney cruise, or Adventures by Disney Vacation, I am here to help you book the best vacation possible, and my expertise and services won't cost you anything extra. Disney pays me, not you. As a perk by booking a package with me, I can also book your dining reservations, park reservations, tours, shuttles, and more. Let me do the hard work while you get excited about your upcoming Disney vacation. I can also book Universal Studios trips as well. By booking with me this year, you will receive 3 months free of our Patreon perk, like our bonus episodes, and join in on our current events live. So contact me at lbarron, that's LBARRON, at concierge.com, that's concierge.com, or thesweepspot@gmail.com. So, Shawna, did you grow up in California?
Yes, I am fourth generation Orange County. Great. And I was born in Yorba Linda and raised mostly in Yorba Linda, went to high school in Fullerton, and then lived in Fullerton for about 25 years. And I'm now actually back in Yorba Linda.
Oh, nice.
So I'm just kind of stuck here. It's the, it's there some, I'm so close to the Nixon Library. I think it's like, you know, there's like something in the soil that keeps me coming back over here.
Probably. So did you go to Disneyland growing up since you were in that, lived in that area?
I did. I was actually very lucky that myself and my three other siblings, we were pass holders from a very early age. I think probably when they first started instating the passes, like back in the, like, I think 1991, I had a pass, and it was ridiculous. You know, I think it was like $70, something like that. Yeah. And that was kind of our, like our, you know how they say there's your third place. That was kind of like our third place. Like, you know, mom would drop us off, you know, she would drop my sister and I off, you know, to hang out for a few hours in between, you know, work and games and things like that. And it just kind of became like a place that all of us siblings hung out together. And I was really lucky. And like, you know, and other kids, you know, that you went to school with, they all kind of had a pass too, or they would go a lot. Like, I remember my, I believe either my 8th or my 10th birthday, my mom actually sent my entire class to Disneyland for my birthday, because I think the passes, I think the just the day, just the Disneyland ticket was like $8 or $10, something like that. I'm dating myself by saying all this, but there was a time when you could do stuff like that. Yeah. But yeah, I kind of just grew up on it. And then, you know, you see it from all angles growing up, and there's something about the different moments in your life as an adolescent and as a teenager and everything too, that the different areas mean more to you than anything else. Like, you know, like when you're a kid, you want to stay in Fantasyland. Oh, I gotta go on I gotta go on Mr. Toad a million times, you know, or go to Tom Sawyer's Island. And then when you're a cool when you're a hip teenager, you know, it's all about the big e-ticket rides, you know, and scamming on other kids your age. You know, it becomes that big social boiling pot, which is so much more fun, you know. Now as an adult, I'm just too old to go on some of those rides. I'm like, oh, And yeah. I'm like, can we just have some chicken and just sit for a little bit? This sounds lovely.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Well, it sounds like, yeah, we all kind of had a similar story. You know, we all had annual passes before we worked at Disneyland, and it was just the thing you did in Southern Cal. It's almost like if you were a kid in that era, you had to have an annual pass.
Yeah. 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 Yeah, I think, you know, I count myself, you know, we weren't well off, but it was like the one thing that my mom always tried to make sure that we had, because she knew how much it meant to us. My dad's family was actually there on opening day. So him and, you know, a bunch of local Orange County families were invited. So he got to go with a couple of his brothers. So it was like one of those things that, yeah, it just is nice that it literally is our backyard.
Yeah. Yeah, we are very lucky to have been able to have it grow up that way for sure. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So what drew you to and when to work at Disneyland?
So I had an interesting history with Disney. Just had wanted to be in the animation program, you know, in my early teens in high school. I thought that's what I was going to do. So I had kind of, you know, pigeonholed my career aspects looking at animation. And when I graduated, I realized that just wasn't, Cal Arts was not what I wanted to do. It was kind of a bridge too far. It was a little more expensive than I really wanted to burden my parents with, and I wasn't excited about going from a high curriculum private school to a college right away. And I just decided, you know, I need a break, and I took the summer to think about it. But you know, everyone's like, well, you got to get a job, you can't just hang out. And I'm like, yeah, but I don't really want a job either, but but I understand. I get it. And what's really funny is, so you know, here it is July, and my dad found a classified ad in the newspaper. Those were things that were real back then too.
And yes.
It was an ad for entertainment art. And he's like, you should apply. You should totally do it. He's like, you're so talented. You know, you're such, I'm like, I don't know. They're not going to hire some kid. And lo and behold, I got an interview, and I went down and I brought my high school portfolio, all my art and paints, and even like all of the t-shirts and things that I designed for the sports teams you know, doodles and things. And they're like, that's great. But can you lift, you know, 40 pounds? And I'm like, sure. And so I lifted this palm tree that was by his desk, and he's like, you got the job. I'm like, seriously? He's like, yeah. He's like, most of this job is lifting. I'm like, okay, but you still have to know how to do stuff. He's like, can you do stuff? I'm like, sure, I can do stuff. And he's like, okay. And literally 1996, July, I was thrown into entertainment art and got to work in the art department doing some amazing things for the parade floats and for private party design, like Indiana Jones parties. I got to do like props and design, and you put like to the plants together. And then I got to move on to parade floats and working on Small World Holiday. And I did that. I was in entertainment art for 5 years, and that was awesome. I learned so much. And when I left the department, I was still the youngest person in the department. Oh. They were great. You know, you know, cast members, we take care of each other, you know, and they taught me so much and took me under their wing. And it pushed me to my next phase at Disney. So I couldn't have done it without them. It was awesome.
Wow.
Yeah.
What a time to come in too, because it was kind of around, you know, I came in 98 to custodial. Ken had already been there since 90, but a lot going on during that time. And yeah, the Small World overlay, that was really it was really popular. I remember how long the line was.
Yeah. There were so many special things that were implemented at those times, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Well, where do you want to start? I mean, we can kind of talk a little bit about some of those projects you mentioned. The Indiana Jones.
Yeah. So like, you know how companies would rent out a hotel space or literally close down the park, you know, and have a party at the park. Entertainment Art would go in and theme out these photo locations or, you know, the podium areas or where the food would be. And everything would be propped out to look like you literally picked up the props from the movies or the ride and had them around for these photo locations. And the same thing would be in these hotels. We would even bring in a full-size Jeep or a truck or something, and then a boatload of plants and set up all of these props. And so during the times that I would be in the warehouse, I would be making the film quality props for the guests to look at. So I did, like, you know, Dr. Jones's Grail Diary. So we would make a couple of those. We would mold out the Staff of Ra. And this is before, like, the internet was really a kind of an end-all source for everything. We were using film spec pictures to try to, like, is this what looks okay, this looks good, I think we got this. Yeah. You know, like a Lucasfilm archive book, you know, was what I used on a lot of things. It was fun. And so it was really cool going from, you know, being like, not even the summer before, being a high school kid going on Indiana Jones because it had just opened, you know, and then to propping out these parties and getting inspiration from the ride and being able to go onto the queue and the ride and take pictures of, like, to make stuff. So it was a trip. It was really fun.
Yeah. I couldn't imagine being that young and doing that. And I mean, you must have been super excited or nervous. I don't know.
I was. And it's funny, 'cause, like, even when you're that young, you think you're so much older too. Yeah. But, you know, and I'm like, oh, but I still marvel at it. Like, oh my gosh, I did so many things as a kid.
So what were some of the other big events you did before? Because you did mention you went on to a different role, but what were some of the others during this time period?
I had also, our team had worked on, the Small World Holiday Overlay, which was a huge undertaking. Right. And I made like 2,000 Mylar bows, you know, in 1 week, and then doing these beautiful floral wreaths for the causeway that leads up to all, you know, the different countries of these wreaths. And also, you know, like, we hadn't done this before, so we're having to kind of, like, trial and error, like, hey, well, what works here, what works there. And, you know, they didn't sell white garland anywhere. And I think people kind of get blind to decor now because there's so many things available to the world as it is. But in the 90s, you had to have things, like, specially made. So there was a company that made things in Mexico, and they handmade all of those white garlands for us. And we would have to, like, order giant lengths and then just cut them to where we thought they would fit. And then you light them yourselves, and then you add all the ornaments and the balls and everything to them, and then the bows. And we had a crew of like 30 people working nonstop. And then they moved us directly right after Small World. They moved us to working on the Light Magic Parade. Oh, I don't know if you guys remember Light Magic.
Yeah.
It was here for a hot minute.
How could I ever forget? It's still on hiatus.
I know. Oh my God. The funniest thing was getting, like, the farewell tag of Main Street Electrical Parade.
Right.
And then in the same week getting, oh, it's Light Magic now. And within, you know, what, less than a year, oh, you know, Electrical Parade's back. Oh, that was quick. But man, that was so much work. I had never worked overtime like that until I moved on to my other department. Mm-hmm. But gosh, that was a such a crazy time. The 90s were a crazy time.
They were,
you know. But yeah, so lucky.
What a crazy idea. I mean, there's no doubt a lot of work was put into it. You know, they changed the whole the parade route, and everything was kind of altered a little bit, and like you did a lot of work and you saw that, and just I don't know, but some of the ideas were a little strange.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about it, they even like took the trees out on Main Street. Like that was when they did that. It was like they realized that how these floats were built, the trees were blocking the projections that needed to be put onto these screens, and on and lighting effects and everything too. And so they thought, oh, let's just take the trees out. I'm like, what? Like, okay, I guess. And that was a somebody, I don't want to say they were on drugs, but somebody had to have, you know, maybe had a lucid dream of some kind to get that passed, by, you know, the higher ups.
Yeah,
but it was still fun.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah.
And the saddest thing is the electrical parade went away and was never ever seen
again. No, no one ever saw it again. It's in a crate completely down gone. There. It's down in the warehouse, you know, looking after by top men. You know, no one's
nobody ever saw it again.
Yeah, electrical parade. I feel like the electrical parade is the thing they put in there when things start to fail. They're like, bring in the electrical parade.
Yeah, I feel it's so true. I feel like, ooh, our attendance is down. Mm-hmm. We got to get the SoCal people to come back. Yeah. Oh, let's just throw the electrical parade out. They don't care that there's a float from Florida in there. Just throw it in there.
Yeah,
they'll still come.
California DCA's, we're having attendance problems. Bring over the electrical.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. They just need three floats. We're good.
Wow. So how long were you in that department, the one we're talking about right now?
So entertainment art, I was there from July 96 to like February 2001.
Oh,
okay. They laid us off, but they gave us the option to stay on with show support. Mm-hmm. And show support and the techs, you know, it's all the people who wear black,
right.
and people who drive floats. So they told us that a lot of us artisans who just wanted to, like, we just want to wear our white overalls and just stay in the warehouse. They're like, no, if you want to stay, you have to transfer over and then learn how to drive parade floats. And I'm like, oh, well, I don't really want to do that. And like, well, it also comes with a pay cut. And we're like, ooh, I really don't want to do that. So it was rough because, you know, here I was just some, you know, 19-year-old kid and, you know, getting paid more than, you know, even some of my siblings were getting paid. And I went from like doing really well to like, ooh, well, we can only offer you $6 an hour. And you'll have to start from the bottom and move up. And I went, you know, I think I'm just going to finish my degree instead, and I'll see you guys later. And that was hard because I really wasn't expecting my tenure to kind of stop right there. And, but it was good because, you know, I took time to explore other things that I'm good at.
Yeah.
And I was, you know, so for those 3 years, I taught art at a couple schools and taught ceramics, and I taught, you know, grade school art, and I also worked for the Boy Scouts. Oh. So I kind of I honed my skills on the other things that I had been doing even during all this time. And it was good. It was a nice break, and it was a chance for me to maybe think about my own business. And I was teaching summer school in 2004 at the high school that I went to. And I got a call from a cast member who I used to work with in entertainment art. And she's like, hey, we're hiring and I'm a manager now. So would you want to come in for an interview? And I'm like, sure. What could it hurt? You know, she's like, this is a different department. We do different things, but it's still creative. And I'm like, yeah, sure, let's do it. And so I had my summer school week, and you know, I had been there all summer, and then so at the end of the week, I had my interview on a Thursday, and I got hired on a Friday, and I started on a Monday. So It was a nice transition to kind of go from, you know, not knowing what the heck I'm going to do the rest of the year to being in this new department. And so I moved into resort enhancement, which was a totally different type of creativity, but it was still very much the same as entertainment art, just more permanent. And it really asked a lot more of me with my creativity and my skill set, and even just my own knowledge of the parks itself and history. And I really flourished in resort enhancement. It was amazing.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, when you mentioned that you'd left in February of 2001, so you were there through the opening of California Venture and all that.
So or not really.
That? Okay.
Because they kept, officially that's when I left, but they kind of like stopped hiring, because they had us on these crew schedules. And so I kind of went from like being there every week to being there maybe once a month.
Oh.
But I was still on pay, like I was still on the schedules, like the, oh, okay, well, we need you to come and do like an environmentality, you know, pop up somewhere, like in, you know, in Anaheim or in Torrance somewhere. I'm like, okay. And so my last like real thing I think I did was November of 2000, but I kept calling, and so you would have to still go down to the crew and artisan warehouse every week just to see if you got on schedule. So I would still have to drive down there and go, hey, am I on schedule? Oh, doesn't look like it. And then you go home, and then you can call, but he won't tell you if you are or not. You have to go and see on if you're on the clipboard for the week or if there's anything coming up. And then you can ask, hey, if did somebody cancel, can I take their spot instead? And so it was rough. And so for a few months, I just kind of went, hey, you know what? If I'm not on anything, can you just like drop me and or at least wait until the other stuff comes up? Because we knew that DCA was coming up. Like we knew that there were things that were going to start happening, and it just never did. And I kind of felt the writing on the wall. You know, they were giving us less and less hours. And you know, if you weren't higher up in the department, I feel like, you know, they weren't going to keep you anyway. So it's fine.
Yeah.
You know, it's fine. Cause, by the time I came back in 04, I was really much more involved in DCA, because then one of my areas of responsibility was the shops down, you know, the main street. And, I was in charge of like Tower of Terror. And, we were in charge of, downtown Disney shops as well. So the World of Disney, there used to be a shop called, Vault 28. I don't know if anybody remembers that. There was some really cool stuff there. And then like Wonderground, and there was something else that was there. Oh, I don't remember. But you know, so like we were kind of spread all over the place. And but yeah.
What did you do for Tower of Terror?
So there was a shop that was connected to it, and a window. And the Zort Enhancement, I was on the windows and interiors team. And everybody had, like, there was six of us, and there was one person who was the florist who would help us out with stuff. And then the rest of us, we were split to our own areas of responsibility. So when I first started, my first 6 months there, I had parts of Main Street. So we had Main Street divvied up between the three of us, and I had Toontown. And then I had so you know, downtown Disney, and then DCA, so the shops in DCA, and then Tower of Terror had its own shop and window. And so I would just, you know, zhuzh that and all that kind of stuff too. And as I got you know, as well as like, you would also make sure that the things leading up to the attraction were taken care of. The props team did all of the static stuff. So they would do mostly the things on the attractions if they needed our help, you know, like, cause they knew they, as soon as people knew how you, that you could do things, they would go, oh, hey, can you help me out with this? You know, like, oh, you can sew. Awesome. Can you do this? I'm like, ah, oh, great. Okay. Sure. Right. I guess I'll make your drapes, you know, or I guess I'll, you know,
yeah.
But yeah, so like once they knew I knew how to sew, I did like the animated figures. So like their clothes. Mm-hmm. And when we were ramping up to the 50th, you know, I got so much more added onto my plate because, oh, great. Well, now that you're, you know how to do these things and you're a history person and we need you to do this and we need you to go research this. And it was implemented into our areas. And by that time I had absorbed Fantasyland as part of my area. Mm. And that was awesome. I'm still so happy with everything I did for Fantasyland. I did Bibbidi Bobbidi Boutique and it's like going in there now, still, I'm so proud of it. It's still beautiful.
Yeah.
And you know, yeah, I mean, even like on Main Street, my things are still being used every day or every week, you know, every season. It's nice that you end up creating these little legacies that kind of live on, even if you're not there.
Yeah.
And they're not going to be there forever. I know that, but it's still nice that I can still walk, I can still walk down Main Street and show my mom, hey, I did that, you know?
That's neat.
Yeah.
That's one thing Disney does well is just decorating, and
yes,
the shops are themed just as well as, you know, anything else. Yeah.
I think it's really important that Disneyland sticks to that story. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that as you guys have known over the years, I'm sure you've observed it, that we kind of got away from that really neat inherent story of the space to make way for better merchandise or, you know, more colors and things like that. And as I've been to other theme parks, I'm really proud of us that we were always known for being the original and that we have that little like soft patina of being this beautiful little jewel box of a park that, people get it. They resonate with it. And they, and when you paid attention to that type of detail, even if you don't think that people are going to notice it, they do notice it.
Mm-hmm.
And they also notice when things are dirty or broken or not working, you know? And I think just as much as they notice when things aren't working, they notice when things are just beautiful and, and have, and you have this emotional response to something. And that's what was so great about my job. You have like 3 seconds to get somebody's attention and to give them, you know, a little memory to take with them. And that is so important. And it's so much more to, you know, the attraction can be amazing. The attraction can be thrilling and can, you know, make you pee your pants. But if it doesn't look cool, if it doesn't have everything else around it supporting it and having that story, then, you know, it's no better than a carnival. And I was really lucky to be somebody who left their mark just by being creative and just by knowing how to sew, knowing how to paint, and knowing how to, you know, how to do flowers and things like that.
For sure. Yeah, the 50th was, you know, there hasn't been a celebration like it since. And it was just amazing just to, you know, we were working there then, and it was just, I mean, from the parade to the fireworks show is still my favorite fireworks show they had ever done.
Same, same here. It makes me cry every time I hear it.
It's just, and all the 50s everywhere and the little hidden Mickeys.
I loved when we did all the attraction cars, gold. There was like a gold teacup and a gold, like Jingles was gold for the year. Yeah, there was a gold something everywhere. It was awesome.
Dumbo,
gold Dumbo, I mean, they were, I mean, they were the static ones that you could just take a picture in, but it was still cool.
Right, yeah. It's so neat. They had those little, what are those called? Little collages of like photos. I think they were cast member photos. I think some were guests.
Mosaics.
Mosaics. That's it.
Yeah. I felt like, I mean, I'm sure you guys can attest to that, you know, that I feel like there are so many things that we may have taken for granted as cast members that they took such good care of us in times like that.
Yeah.
And I'm sad when I hear that it's not that way anymore.
I know.
And, and, you know, but I always like, I'm hopeful that it's going to get better because they deserve it. Mm-hmm, you know, they work so hard and it should be a place that you are so excited to be at. And you can't wait to like see yourself like featured in the line or, or in the mosaic, you know, or, or even mentioned somewhere.
Did you have a question, Ken?
No.
Okay.
I was just thinking you got to play the fireworks music so you can get her to cry. No.
Well, I bought, I bought the 50th LP set that they had when they were selling in the music shop that year. And, you know, I've listened to it more than enough times, but that's something I'm so happy that I spent the money on because it's so rad just to have the record itself and then have all those CDs and I can, because it's not on Spotify, because I could play it anytime I want.
Yeah, that's a great thing to have. I have that too. It's really neat. So I was going to ask you about the Haunted Mansion, but was that before? Mm-hmm. Did you do some of the work with that?
So that was for entertainment art in the 90s. Okay. And that was, so it moved from, so entertainment art used to be in charge of all the hotel Christmas decor, as well as the attraction seasonal decor. And it has, they still take care of Small World and Haunted Mansion. And but the peripheral areas that have to do with the holidays that aren't the attraction, so like the French Market used to get a overlay of Nightmare Before Christmas. Resort Enhancement would take care of that because it's a restaurant. And so we kind of like traded back and forth items that we would use, you know, like the skull molds and things like that. But in the 90s when I was with Entertainment Art, that was one of the things that I actually got to work on, was the holiday decor. Those garlands. And what's so gnarly about those garlands, because like as I said, they didn't have black garland back then. So we would take green garland and they would paint it, spray paint it, and then burn it with a blowtorch to make it black. And so like, it's a little crispy. so there's like, they don't have, like, obviously they've switched them out to actual black garland now that they've, you know, here it is 20 some years later. But it was so funny. And then that ribbon that we used on there, the black and white striped ribbon, we literally took black Mylar ribbon and then white out pens to make the stripes, because we couldn't have it printed. Like we weren't there yet. Yeah. We didn't have the sublimating, that we can do now. So here we all are using rulers and whiteout pens to make these lines down all of these bows. It was hilarious. And you know, like all the little berries and things that we would put in there, we'd burn them and paint them black. And I mean, it looked great.
Yeah,
it looked decrepit, but unfortunately, you know, those things start to fall apart after a few years because you've burnt them.
Yeah.
So it's a good thing that they've upgraded. And it's funny because years ago my name was on the Christmas list.
Oh, it was.
But it was, and like the first like 30 people was everybody from the shop, and then they made them change it because WDI got jealous because they wanted their names on it. So now it's all WDI people.
Well, I know I saw. You know, I always tried to look for names I recognize. I remember Garner Holt, who did all the animatronics,
And it's funny because after I left Disney, I did work for Garner Holt. And I was really lucky. And they still throw me a bone every once in a while. Because I do custom wardrobe pieces for them. So that's really fun. Yeah. And I'm on, you know, good terms with their creative director. So every once in a while I can just like literally check in, hey, you got any work for me? Maybe, you know.
Oh, yeah. They're great. Yeah, they're great.
It's great. Yeah. It really is a small creative world, I have to say.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, I was just thinking as you were saying how much detail went in just the ribbon, I thought, you know what? They didn't have to do that. And
no,
Disney does those sort of things. It's just
exactly,
it's crazy, but it's nice.
Exactly. It really is. And you know, next time, you know, you don't think about it and you're kind of perusing, you know, Main Street or whatever, like really look at something, you know. Yeah. The last big redesign that I did was the clothiers shop on Main Street, and every single piece in those uppers, I made those. And I'm so proud of it. And it's still there, holding up. Everything is exactly the way it was when I sewed everything. And I'm so happy that I can go back and see that my work is still speaking for itself, you know? Yeah, and you don't think about like, oh, those are just Victorian clothes that they found to put on these forms to make them look like props, you know. No, I had to buy, you know, the fabric so that all of the fabric tells a color story, and then I made sure that all of the fashions were appropriate to this very specific time period, and what will the kids wear, and what will, you know, what would men use in their their pockets and things like that. So, you know, we really pride ourselves in even the tiniest details that we stay within that show story. And, you know, I think it's great when cast members can personify that they can, you know, make it literate for everybody else to see where, you know, maybe not people, I don't think people know that what type of shaving kits you could buy in 1911, but right. We do.
Yeah. Yeah. That's really neat. So when you put up, say, like a Christmas, over the holidays, you had Christmas decorations, and you wanted to keep them somewhat the same as last year. Did they just take a lot of photos and you refer to those, or?
Absolutely. Yeah. So the Christmas team, that team, they work year round on resort enhancement. They, they're in charge of everything that's on the outside. So like the trees, the festoons, all of the garlands that you see down Main Street, as well as like the garlands and the larger trees everywhere else. So they, Resort Enhancement does the resort. So Disneyland, DCA, as well as the hotels. So everything gets cataloged. And even during the time when things are installed, for all of us, all of our teams, we have to make sure that we go and maintain things. So you go every day or every couple of days and you look at how things are holding up. Are the lights still working? Is it dusty? You know, did someone steal an ornament off of it?
Right.
You know, which happens, you know. I know you guys are shocked, but they do steal ornaments. And so we make sure that we take pictures of everything. And if we do want to, let's say, change the color story of one of the stores, then we take the pictures that we used last year and the items, we pull them out and we look at them and we go, ooh, you know what? I really love this, but I think I want to do like a Nutcracker theme instead. And so we'll change it up. And usually depending on what area you're looking at, every block on Main Street and every window has its own budget. So every little window and every little store has its own budget. So you, if you want to stay within there, you can say, hey, I'd like to get all new stuff. I want to make it all brand new, new drapes, new this, new that. I was like, okay, that's great. But you have to stay within this amount. And so with our warehouse, it's full of props and it's full of fabric and it's full of flowers and it's full of all kinds of things that, and furniture that you can just basically go pick and go, yeah, I think this works. And you can lay it out on your desk and see if everything works and go from there. So what's really crazy about Christmas is that you've seen the consistency of just Main Street. So everything is cataloged, every size of ornament, every size of light bulb, how many light bulbs, how many strands of LEDs go on each thing, especially the safety stuff, because everything is has its own standards of, you know, your where your hooks are and where you attach things to the building, so that even if somebody starts in the middle of the year, they could literally open up the binder and go, oh, okay, this goes here, this goes there, so that there's consistency across the board.
Yeah, I had a little taste of that, and I don't know if this is the same warehouse, but I hurt myself in custodial one time, and they put me on, light duty or whatever. And
yeah,
They sent me over to this warehouse off of Ball, I believe.
Yeah.
And we
You probably went to, well, what year was this?
Oh, just before I left, 2005, 6.
Okay, so yeah, you were on Cerritos at the Cerritos warehouse where they share it with Company D.
Yeah.
And I was in that warehouse at the same time. You probably saw me. And so in 2005, you would have sat with like the Christmas team.
Yeah.
And like, yeah. We did, and, you know,
ribbon fluff garland or something. And,
yeah. Yeah.
It, my memory
are you,
is...
Are you a bow master now?
I am. But my memory is I remember there was a lady who was really into Neil Diamond, and that's like we listened to for hours.
I'm so sorry. Yes.
You remember that?
Yes, I'm very well aware of her. Yeah.
Yeah, and I thought, oh, please change it.
Yeah. I was obsessed with ABBA, so I still am.
Oh,
so okay. I was on the other side of the fence. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's funny.
Crank up the Weird Al Yankovic. Okay.
Oh, heck yeah.
Yeah, I was there for a whole week.
Oh, wow. Fun.
It was
limited work, Lynn. It was limited work.
But a lifetime of skill. Yeah, limited work, exactly. But a lifetime of, you can carry that with you forever.
It was really neat. And when they first showed me around, we went up and down the aisles like you were talking about, and we had all this really neat. Yeah.
Yeah. So you could see like literally like all of like here's all of the tables. Mm-hmm. Here's all the settees. Here's all of this, you know, and all the crates and boxes of, you know, bookends and, you know, giant carrots or whatever.
Right. Right. Wow. That's neat. Let's see, where else? So anything else you want to mention? Did you get to, you know, meet any cool people or, you know, anything?
I have one from Nobody Believes Me, but it happened, and it happened in broad daylight, so there are witnesses. They just like to gaslight me into saying it didn't happen.
Okay.
In 1997, when I was working on a podium on Main Street. So like they would have the podium set up in front of the castle, you know, with like ferns around it and florals and things and a stage, because they were announcing something. And I honestly have no recollection of what they were announcing. Who knows? Yeah. Could be anything. And it was like 6 a.m. and I'm in my white, you know, Dickies coveralls, and I'm just the kid, and I had been there all night, and the rest of my team went and took their last break. And I was left to just zhuzh all of these ferns and everything. And I'm just by myself. And there's like security guards kind of hanging out. And I look over, you know, I hear over my shoulder, hey, that looks great. And I look up at this man, and I'm like, oh, wow, thank you. He's like, no, keep up the good work. And it was Roy Disney. And you cannot tell me that didn't happen, because it happened.
Yeah.
Because it was amazing. And I like it. I just was so, you know, I was 19, and I was just so completely dumbfounded. If it had happened now, I would have probably been more talkative and, you know, probably given him my card or something. But, but like, oh, it just, you know, I think we've all had this experience when you've had a really long day, and you just feel so completely like, am I even doing a good job? Like, am I even like, why am I even here? You know, I've got, you know, stains all in my fingernails are stained from the plants and the paint and everything else. And then somebody that you just never would have suspected just says you're doing a great job. Yeah. And that just, I feel like as soon as that happened, everything changed for me there. And it really gave me so much more confidence to, not be this kind of shrinking violet, because I was, even though, you know, we all have this kind of imposter syndrome, and I didn't believe I was that talented when I was hired in the first place, but I'm like, well, joke's on them, you know, they hired me anyway. And I really was, I was really good at what I did. And, yeah. And, it kind of just said, you know what, it reset me. And it made me come out of my shell more. And I asked for more responsibilities, and I asked for better projects. And, you know, it carried me even all through my next jobs and through working for Resort Enhancement. And even ultimately now, you know, because I just, maybe I just needed that one person to say, hey, you're kicking ass. And thank God, you know, you know, because you'll always have people who naysay. But man, that was great. I mean, I've met other people, you know, peripherally, because of, like, you know, because like when you're out on Main Street as a third shifter, you see people rehearsing all the time.
Yeah.
So you always see celebrities, especially around candlelight. You'll always see people rehearsing, and all kinds of celebrities. But nothing meant as much to me as that one, you know. And I mean, how do you top that?
I don't know. He probably had no idea how much it impacted you and meant to you, you know.
I'm just some schmo, you know, but gosh, you know. Yeah, I was really lucky that happened to me.
Wow. Well, I feel like we could talk more, but I don't want to keep you too much longer. Oh. But what are you, so when did you leave?
So I was let go in 2011. I was you know, story for another day.
Yeah.
But I think we all have those stories.
Yeah.
It was not anything to do with my job performance, my merit, nothing like that. It was unfortunately very political. Yeah. And in 2011, I think, you know, there were certain things that were happening within the company that they hadn't really grown into yet. And now, if it had happened, I probably would still be there because of the types of protections that I would have. Mm-hmm. But either way, it happened. And, you know, I, like you do, you kind of mourn it like a death. And I didn't know what I was going to do. And so I was let go in July of 2011. And I was, you know, I brushed myself off. I figured out what I'm going to do next. I got a divorce. And no, it was fantastic. No, trust me, it was great.
Okay.
And I will always be more upset about losing my job than losing him. So I'm good. And I didn't lose him. I know exactly where he is. So I can avoid it.
you've got a tracking device.
No,
right now.
Yes. Thank God. I can call, you know, NOAC right now and say, okay, can we get a satellite feed on him right now? Thank you.
Yeah.
And, yeah. And I just said, well, gosh, what do I want the rest of my life to look like? And, you know, I took everything that I received from Disney, every inherent attaboy and everything that I learned on the job. And I realized that, you know what, I am still 100% as talented as I was as I was the day I left. Mm-hmm. So what do I do now? And I still work, you know, volunteering with the Boy Scouts. I have my own business. I was really lucky that it happened at a time. I moved back in with my parents, and you never know how much time you have with your folks. And I repaired that relationship with them, and it's been beneficial and amazing. Severe ups and downs.
Yeah.
And they have supported me and my creative journey this entire time, and I would not be where I am now without them. And now I get to go to Disneyland with my little Disney buddy, my little mom, and we go have lunch, and we go have our Plaza Inn, and we hang out, and it's great. And it's made me a better person, that I will challenge myself to take these types of jobs that I probably would not have taken if I'd still been at Disney, because I was so scared to do things on the outside that scared me, that were like too big, or just, oh my God, there's no way. What if they find out, you know, or, you know, it's silly stuff like that. But, you know, God, you know, I'm working on something really amazing right now. And I can tell you guys, it's really cool.
Yeah.
It's a tiki thing. And I've, you know, I have grown into the tiki community in the last 10 years. I was a vendor since 2014 at Don the Beachcomber and other various peripheral places. I'll be doing my Tiki Oasis this summer. But I was asked by Tommy Allsmiller, who goes by Typhoon Tommy, and his dad was, oh my God, Jeff Allsmiller, right? Is that his dad's name? I'm so bad. Edit this out. Don't put this in. Anyways.
sorry.
His dad, his dad was the gentleman who designed the Nautilus for Disneyland and all of the ride cars and things like that. And he's still alive and he's awesome. He lives in Florida. And so Tommy, he hired me to work on the Maikai with him. And the Maikai is this beautiful jewel in the crown of tiki restaurants in Fort Lauderdale that was built in 53, opened in 56. And it was such a beautiful destination that Walt Disney sent his Imagineers down there to get ideas for the Tiki Room. Wow. And I think it's such a weird, crazy full circle that here I am working in the place that Walt was so in love with that he wanted to share it with the rest of the world. And now I'm making that space look better. I'm making it look better than it did when it was open. And it's really, it's so amazing. I would never have been able to do that, you know, if I had still been, you know, making bows.
Exactly.
So, you know.
Well, that's cool.
Yeah.
I like that. And is there, like, did you want to promote anything or?
Well, I'll be at Tiki Oasis, which is a huge annual convention in San Diego. I'll be there. It runs July 31st through the 4th. I will be there the 1st through the 4th. Okay. And I'll have a booth and I sell my like floral accessories and like floral home design and things like that. I'll probably be talking about the Maikai, you know, until people, you know, walk away from me. My business that I do on a daily basis is I'm a studio costumer. So I do film reproduction. I do historical reproduction. And that's what I did some stuff for Garner Holt. I'm also for hire all the time, which is so great about working for yourself. People can check out my Instagram and talk to me through there. I'm working on like pieces for the Kentucky Derby that's coming up. So all of the gals and dudes who wear the fun, you know, hats and everything.
Yeah.
I do things for that. I do wedding dresses and wedding florals and all kinds of fun stuff. Like I don't really want to limit myself to anything. I don't clean windows. I don't do that. But yeah, everything else is you know, it's pretty great. So I'm actually staring at a piece I'm working on right now. I do film reproduction and I'm working on a piece from Guillermo del Toro from Hellboy 2.
Oh yeah.
It was the Angel of Darkness that had the wings, you know, with the eyeballs and everything on it.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been working on that for a little while and I'm almost done with it. So pretty exciting. Yeah.
Wow. Well, it was really nice to get to know you and
oh my gosh, yeah. It was I'm really stoked that you hit me up.
Yeah, for sure. Well, thank you again.
For sure. Let me know if you want to hear any other crazy stories.
Well, I'm sure we will.
We got ghost stories too. Those are always fun.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we'll definitely have you back.
Okay.
Wow, what a great episode. I always love talking with former cast members, even if they weren't in the same department as we were, because I like hearing their perspective, you know?
Yeah. You know, I frequently say that I could listen to them a lot longer. And that's true in this case too. It's like, you know, there's so much more that I wanted to find out and hear, but we realized that they need a break and you know, not the listeners have busy lives too. So, you know, we try to give you enough, but we always want you leaving. We want you to want more as well. So just stay subscribed to us. If you're not subscribed to us, do subscribe to us wherever you find podcasts. And that way you won't miss anything.
That's right. Yeah, we'll definitely have her back before the end of the year. I want to get into this section where we read some of the reviews we've had recently. And we actually have three. So I'm going to read the first one. It is titled Fun to Listen To. The date just says Saturday. So whatever the date was last Saturday, the 13th, I think. I don't know. Yeah. Moving on. So Disney Gal 18. It says, I love most things about this show. I do think you should vet your guests better. Some of these former cast members probably should not be guests on podcasts. They ramble, sometimes are inappropriate in the way they talk about other cast members by name, and are just hard to listen to for the length of time you allow them to talk unchecked.
Huh. Yeah, well, I used to, I think, stop the guest. I used to interrupt too often, I think.
Yeah.
So I let them talk as long as they've got steam, you know. Now, if they started veering off into their favorite recipe that has nothing to do with Disney parks, then,
right.
You know, I might stop that. But no, I've been working on just prompting people to tell their stories. And we give a behind the scenes look, and it's not always going to be polished, or a lot of these people are not public speakers. I mean, a few people are.
I'm not,
you know, and so it's really not, you know, most of these people are regular people. I mean, some of them, you know, we've had like Robin, who's, you know, she was an ambassador. Those people are polished with their deliveries and stuff like that. But, you know, we're talking to regular cast members in some cases. We want to get their stories too, because we try to give a perspective from all over the place. And we've had people on the program who hate each other.
Yeah.
We didn't talk about it. We probably didn't talk about it during the program. But we've had people on here who hate each other's guts. They would never do like a round table together.
Right. Yeah, we'd never have them together. But yeah.
Right. We would never have them together. They would disagree on certain things that happened, you know, or how they happened or whatever like that. But it's not, you know, unless we were present, you know, we don't know. And I mean, there's, you know, sometimes people think, did that really happen? And I hear these stories and I go, I know that these things can happen. you know?
Yeah. And maybe sometimes people, it sounds ridiculous, but
maybe
yeah.
People like say them in a dramatic way or whatever.
Yeah.
But anyway, so, but we do, we appreciate the feedback. We'll take it under advisement, yeah. You know.
I did want to say one thing though, that, and maybe, I should say this up front in the beginning. Sometimes the premise of the show, at least in my eyes, has always been more of a relaxed situation where it's sort of like we're just sitting around chatting with as friends or not even friends, just people that we come across. Hey, you worked at Disneyland, and just kind of start talking to them. So sometimes that relaxed feeling brings out, you know, things. So. Yeah, and, you know what I mean.
And a lot of times when we talk to people who were custodial and they'll mention somebody by name, a lot of times you can find those names in our books. So ding, 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 ding. Yeah. If you haven't read our books, read them and you'll understand more of what's going on. But I do try to, I'm trying to get better at this where I say, okay, explain what, you know, explain who you're talking about or what, you know, who that person was, what their position was. Because our listeners might not know. We just kind of assume that our listeners are extremely experienced in at following Disneyland and knowing Disneyland history, you know, things like that. And that's not always the case.
And that's okay.
You know, they might not know where something was, or, you know, that there was this shop or this attraction or something. So sometimes I'm trying to get better at that, where it's like, okay, well, let's take a couple seconds to explain what that was or whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, either way, we read them, and sometimes we have to maybe explain a little bit more. But yeah, that was good. Thank you so much. Really do appreciate it. So we have two more. I want to read. This one's called "Been Listening for." Too long. No. April 11th, 2024. Aurora of Foreboding says, just want to say you guys are amazing. That's it? No. I appreciate how you're Disney explaining the park's history to listeners who might not be aware.
Ah, see? All right.
We can't all be blessed with a vast amount of Disneyland knowledge like us. Okay. Keep up the good work. Also, I know you guys love to talk about all the good times in Custodio. I would love to hear an episode about the bad times. I feel the best Disneyland fan is one that is passionate about it and critical when they need to be. Oh, well, that kind of, yeah, kind of, that actually does blend into this, that other
review. See, there's, I'm sure there's people who say, no, I don't want to hear about those bad times. It's right. It's unprofessional to talk about it or whatever. I don't know. I mean, we have talked about a lot of the bad times in the books. We've mentioned things on the program before. I don't know about
doing a whole episode on it, but I'll have to think about that. I mean, it's not a bad idea, and I think I've wrote that down a long time ago as not necessarily the bad, but
follow us on social media. I actually tweeted something or posted, if I don't know what the terminology is now, but I posted something not recently where it was a thread, because some of the people we work with were talking, you know, being used as an example by parents. While you're sitting there working, right? You're like sweeping up the horse crap on Main Street or whatever. And a parent brings their child over to you and says, see, this is why you got to do well in school. Otherwise, you're going to end up like this person. They would do that to our face.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's a completely, I mean, I'm not going to go on the whole thing right now, but it's a completely ignorant statement, because a lot of the people we worked with were great students.
Had degrees, multiple degrees.
Well, had advanced degrees.
Yeah. You know?
And I worked there for years after I had completed college and had my degree.
And had a job, had another job. Yeah.
Right. You know, some people work there, you know, they have other jobs, they're freelancers, they're artists, whatever.
Police officer. We had a police officer there who did the studio.
So you just don't know people's circumstances to say that. And I'm not going to go into the whole thing right now, but that was, if you want an example of the bad times, that was one of them. That's worse. I think that's worse than cleaning up diarrhea.
I'd much rather clean up code V's or whatever,
right, than to have someone do that. And it's just like, what are you, you know? Well, I will say this, more importantly than being educated, we work with a lot of great people.
Yeah.
And your child growing up to be a good person is more important, I think. And I say that as somebody who highly values education. Okay.
Yeah.
I had a lot of teachers in my family, but I'm telling you, being a good person is even more important. So teach your child to be a good person.
Yeah. I know a lot of, I was going to say idiots, but that have degrees, and I know a lot of really intelligent, nice people that don't, you know.
So. Yeah.
All right, moving on. We have one more to read. This one was just a couple days ago as of this recording. It's titled Number One, 5 stars.
All right.
Oh, I should have mentioned that first one that we read was four stars out of five. So this one's five stars. Says, as a Disney podcast listener, I recently went through and unsubscribed from some of the podcasts I no longer listen to. Obviously, the Sweep Spot was not one of them. I love all the interviews as well as the history included in the episodes. I have also read both books and highly recommend to any Disney lover. Keep up the good work and look forward to hearing more episodes in the future.
Signed, Ken. No, I'm...
Well, that was by AZ Diz Fan. So.
Oh, wow. And that was... Thank you so much. That's...
Yeah.
That's great. That's... I'm honored that we made the cut and that you have read the books and recommend us. And I hope that we will prove to be worthy, going forward. Thank you so much.
Yeah, if you'd like to leave a review, we'd really appreciate it. You can do that by, if you listen on Apple Podcasts or iTunes, you can do that. If you leave a review somewhere else, that you listen somewhere else, because I don't follow all the places we have them posted, but you can send me what you wrote and we will read it on our next episode. So thank you so much for listening. Really appreciate everyone, and we'll talk with you next time.